Begin this morning in Acts chapter 5, verse number 24. I'll be reading out of the King James Version. The title of today's message is Jesus Christ and the Chamber of Fire. It says in chapter 5, verse number 24, when the high priest and the captain of the temple and the chief priest heard these things, they doubted of them whereunto this would grow. Father in heaven, we thank you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for your holy word. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. Father, we pray for a strong heavenly anointing this morning to be upon the congregation, upon the word, upon myself to share the word. And Father, we pray that that anointing, as your word says, would work to break the chains, the yokes, and the bondages that we are under each and every day, each and every week, and set us free by the word of God, and let truth reign in our hearts this morning. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. So Acts chapter 5, verse number 24, serves a singular purpose this morning. It's not so much about what's going on in Acts chapter 5 as it is about this one, just this one phrase that I don't know if you ever noticed until right now. This is one of those things that you can read the chapter, you can read the book 100 times, or at least for me, this is what happened like 4 years ago, the first time I recognize that this phrase was there, though I've read the chapter so many times. I don't know how to explain that. I know that it's happened to you if you read the Bible. One explanation is that, you know, in the dead of night around the world, as the time zones come about, the Lord just likes to come in every once in a while and add something to every single Bible in the universe. And then he writes web pages about it, because you could Google it, and it'll be there too. That's probably not what happens, but that's what it seems like. And so I've been studying this for a long time. For those of you that are visitors, if we major on one thing here, it's Hebrew and Greek study with a major on the Hebrew study and all the temple ordinances, things of that nature. So to not know that this guy exists was a big deal for me. But as you read in Acts chapter 5, verse 24, it clearly says, when the high priest, which is a term we're familiar with, and the captain of the temple. That was, I don't know how I missed that for so many years. I had no idea that there was this guy who had a very profound job in the temple ordinances of old, all throughout the old covenant and also in the days of Christ as the temple still stood, called the captain of the temple. It sounds like a pretty important role. It almost sounds like it's the interchangeable title, like the high priest and the captain of the temple, but it's not. It's two different people. And then it goes on to say, and the chief priest, which is a term we're familiar with. But who is this captain of the temple? There is a question that I had for years in studying the ministry of the high priest. The high priest has so many responsibilities upon his shoulders day in and day out. There's two services every day in the temple, the morning and the evening sacrifice. There's special services on the Shabbat, and then there's seven high holy days throughout the year, three in the spring, three in the fall, one in the summertime, and of those seven high holy days, there's one called the Day of Atonement. On the Day of Atonement, the innumerable responsibilities that the high priest has to take care of, and the amount of just scene changes, like he literally has to change clothes a number of times, he has to wash his hands and his feet in mikvah somewhere around 10 different times. He has to do everything all day long in order, and it's the most important service of the year. It's such a big deal that he literally has to do dress rehearsals for 7 days straight leading up to the day of Yom Kippur. And just in case he gets sick or he doesn't do well in rehearsal, they have alternates that can take his place that have to go through the entire 7-day lead up with him to all of the different rehearsals. It's incredible. My question in studying all that was like, how can one guy fulfill the requirements of this office year in and year out, especially on the Day of Atonement? And it turns out one guy can't. So they have an assistant for this guy called the captain of the temple. The captain of the temple does a lot of the administrative, a lot of the preparatory work for the high priest and all of his responsibilities, especially, again, on the Day of Atonement. So this guy has a very, very interesting job. So what I want to bring to you today is, I guess at this point you'd have to call it, and you might call it an alternative viewpoint on the interesting detail when they came to the tomb and they found the tomb empty. It wasn't exactly empty, was it? He wasn't in there, but something was in there. What was in there? That white folded linen cloth, right? Very curious that it's pointed out. And there have been opinions, theories, hypotheses, good stories told about this linen cloth for eons of time. I think every year on Facebook something circulates about, you know, a new revelation or maybe even an old story about this white linen cloth. And so we all probably have an idea of some really cool things that it could represent. And all of those things are possibilities. But I want to bring to you what I feel like is the primary reason, the primary function, the primary prophetic element of this folded cloth that was inside of the chamber, if you will, of the tomb of Jesus Christ. So before we get there, we got to set some principles down. A good one, a good place to start is in Colossians chapter 2, verse number 16. Colossians 2 and 16 through 17 says the following: "Let no man therefore judge you." Now, when he says therefore, that's a reference to the previous verses in Colossians 2. The previous verses tell the story of him nailing all of the ordinances that were set against us upon the cross whenever he died on the cross and triumphing over the enemy in his resurrection, which, of course, is very appropriate for a day like today. But he's saying one result of his passion, his death, burial, and resurrection, is that no man, therefore, should be able to judge you in meat or in drink or respect of a holy day. Now, meat and drink is a direct reference to the Levitical system, the book of Leviticus, the 613 laws, all the sacrifices, so on and so forth. Or in respect of a holy day, these are the seven high holy days that we spoke of earlier. Or of the new moon, which is how they recognize the new month, is whenever the sliver of the moon would come into the just a little crescent was visible for the first time. They would blow their shofars and they would recognize the new month, and there were certain ordinances surrounding that. Or of the Sabbath, which is, of course, every seventh day, Friday night to Saturday night. Let no man judge you in all of these very lawful things, verse 17, because they are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. So what Paul is revealing to the church at Colossae and then eventually to all the Christians throughout time in perpetual is when we look back at the Old Testament system, it's not to be done away with. It's not to be forgotten. The Old Testament and the Old Covenant, we don't walk by the ordinances of those laws anymore. But those laws serve as a shadow and a type of what we do walk in these days. In other words, if you want to know the intricacies of the character of your Lord and Savior, you want to know the reasons why he did some of the things that he did and said the things that he said, and the verses that were recorded are the verses that are recorded versus a million things that he said and did that weren't recorded, which of course is only logical, but also the Gospel of John points that out, that even some of the more amazing things that he did, if they were recorded, it says there wouldn't be enough room in the world to contain the books. So there's a lot more that wasn't recorded than was recorded. So why these particular things? Well, you can just read the particular things. You can just go through the New Testament and you can try your best to figure it out and you can formulate, hopefully, a well-educated opinion. And what happens if you do that is over the expanse of time, you're going to have hundreds of different opinions. Hundreds of different opinions are going to turn into hundreds of different denominations because there are going to be groups of people who align with different opinions and think this is the best idea. That's inevitable. And that's what's happened over a period of time. So if you see the landscape of denominations and divisions within the body of Christ with the truth of the word, and you want to know who actually is preaching the truth or understands it, whenever that, because the denominations share a lot of similar information, but where they don't, where they butt heads, where they differ, who's right, who's wrong, or maybe everybody's wrong, and we're in certain situations we're still looking for the truth. Who's to say? Well, I'll tell you who's to say. The schoolmaster is to say. And that's what Paul called the Old Testament in the book of Galatians. He called it the schoolmaster. So if you really want to know what's being conveyed in the New Testament through actions and words, you go back to the Old Testament, and that's like your index. And that's one of the reasons why the Old Testament is like three times thicker than the New Testament, because it contains all of the foundational information that leads up to Jesus and the other authors and the other speakers in the New Testament being able to say and do what they did. Like, in other words, where it tells us in the Gospel of John that Jesus Christ came to tabernacle amongst us, as an example. That's one word, tabernacle. But what does that mean? Well, you can form an opinion. A tabernacle is a structure. It's a tent. So he came to camp with us. He came to hang out with us. There's a really good tabernacle choir somewhere. Maybe he came to sing with us. Like, you'd have a lot of opinions. Or you can go back to the Old Testament and guess how many chapters there are in synchronicity describing nothing but the tabernacle, its structure, down to the folds of the curtains and all of the ministries within the tabernacle system. There are 50 chapters. So 50 chapters, not verses, chapters, can be condensed into one. If you know the chapters, which all the Hebrew people would, they're required to, then all that has to be said on the outset is the word tabernacle, and you have 50 chapters of foundational information to understand what that means. Like, for instance, you can go to the Old Testament, and it tells you the month that Moses started to build the tabernacle, and it tells you the month that he finished. You're not going to recognize those names because it's not February and March. It's Hebrew months. But if you get a Hebrew calendar and you do the quick math, the Bible shows that it took Moses exactly 9 months to build the tabernacle. Hey, that relays a message to us about Christ being the tabernacle. He was 9 months in forming in the womb of Mary. And the tabernacle was a house literally made out of skin. Badger skins on the outside, ram skins, lamb skins. So a house of skin, triune, in which the Spirit of God dwelt. Okay, so we're all just those two examples, and we're learning a lot more about the word tabernacle than if we just formulated our best opinion using Webster's Dictionary and Encyclopedia Britannica. That's for you old people. So we do our best, and the best we'll come up with is a denomination. But if we go to the schoolmaster, we can learn. So Colossians chapter 2, verse number 16 and 17 serve to tell us, this is Paul saying, by the way, all of the Old Testament ordinances, everything going on there is a type and a shadow. Some of it is told to you straight up. Okay, you'll read scriptures, especially in the four Gospels, especially in Matthew. Christ will say something or do something, and then Matthew will point out, and this was done so that this was fulfilled from the Old Testament. But then there are a much larger number of things that Christ just says and does. Nobody points out the fulfillment or the type from the old, and you have to go back to it yourself. This celebration is a good example. When Christ first comes on the scene, John the Baptist points to him and says, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." Nobody stops and says, this he said as a signification that Jesus Christ would be the Passover Lamb. It doesn't say that, but when you read further on or further backwards in certain cases, you realize, oh, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world, they're talking about the Passover Lamb. He's the Passover Lamb. And that's the time of the season that we're, you know, celebrating, and we'll be in here in a month. So I say all that to say I want to talk to you about the captain of the temple and the shadowy things that he represents. So everything, first of all, every single thing in the Old Testament is fulfilled in Christ. Christ is in everything. If I had 20 more minutes, I'd go through some of that with you so that we could really make that point. But I'll just say, it might sort of be obvious to you. Let's say John chapter 1, verse 1, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning with God." So we go a few verses later, and it says, "The Word became flesh," around verse 14, 15. "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory as of the glory of the only begotten." So what we learn from John chapter 1, verse 1, and then that whole discourse all the way down to verse 14, is that the Word was in the beginning, and the Word was God, and with God, that's Jesus Christ, who is God, but was also with God, because this is the nature of God. God is a spirit. No man at any time has seen God, but Jesus Christ is the only visible revelation of the invisible God. That's scripture and verse. There's only one name, Acts chapter 4, verse 12, under heaven, by which men can be saved, and that is the name of Jesus Christ. When you've seen me, you've seen the Father. That's what he told Philip. So as difficult as it for us to imagine, this is the unity of what's called the Godhead. So the Word became flesh. That's God becoming flesh. But God is the Word, and the Word is God, and the same was the beginning with God, and this is God. And we beheld the Word becoming flesh. That means Jesus Christ is the Word of God. And the Word of God is Him. So when you're reading the Word, you're reading an encoded explanation of who He is. Kind of like your DNA, how we figured out in recent times that there's a very distinct code. Well, the distinct code of the DNA of Jesus Christ, moving away from the scientific to the metaphysical, is the Word of God. So you can learn everything you need to know about Him in His Word, because He is the Word made flesh. Amen? So you could reasonably conclude from that everything from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 to Revelation 22 is about Him. And He fulfills all of it. And He walks in all of it. As an example, what's one of the first things that happens in Genesis chapter 1? The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Everything calmed down. He said, let there be light. Well, Jesus does that later. They're out on a boat. It's rocking in a storm. Everything's crazy. They think they're going to die. It's form. It's voidless. It's chaotic. And he comes, the Spirit of God, walking across the water. God said, let there be light. Jesus says, it is I. And he is the light of the world. So just as an example, but that happens over and over and over. He fulfills all of it. Now, again, nobody stopped and said he did this as a fulfillment of Genesis chapter 1, verse number 2 and 3. But if you know the verses and you're looking for it, it's kind of in your face. It kind of makes sense. So I want to talk to you about this amazing thing. I want to talk to you about your heart this morning, if that's okay. So, because not only is the Word, is everything in the Word about Him, but He said, you are my body now. He calls, the reason we're called Christians is because we took on His name. And the Bible says we are the body of Christ. So you should also be able to find your own identity within the Word of God, right? That there's so much confusion in the world right now about identity. Okay, there's so many people's minds are playing tricks on them, and they're trying to align their mind with their body, and they don't know what to do. Maybe I'm the wrong gender. Maybe I'm the wrong sex. Maybe I've been put in the wrong body. Yes, you are in the wrong body. You're an eternal being in a temporary body. Yes, your identity is not found in the world, but the world is coming on strong. The reason why you're confused is because your DNA is captured in His DNA, which is captured in the Word of God, but the Word of God is antiquated, outlawed, and ridiculed, whereas Netflix and Hulu and everything else is being propelled and propped up. So it's no wonder that you're confused. Because the light came into the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. He came into His own, and His own didn't know who He was, so they also don't know who they are. So if you want to set your mind straight, you want to know what your identity is, you want your mind and your body to align, get your mind into the Word of God, and He'll fix your psyche, and your soul will be aligned with His Spirit, and you won't be as confused any longer. So it's not just about Him, it's also about us. And us in Him and who we really are. This is not your body. This is a temporary body. You're going to get a glorified body. Maybe that's why it feels confusing. Because you know you were made for something better. You have a hunger for the eternal. Therefore, eternity exists. You know, the reason why you're thirsty is because there's water on this planet. You're hungry and this planet provides food. The things that you yearn for because they're fulfillable. You yearn for eternal life. Guess what? It exists. But it exists in Him. It's very confusing to live a life where it doesn't exist when you know deep down somewhere in your heart and your mind, you know better. It doesn't all end with an absolute blackness as if it never happened. You know better. There will be no point for consciousness. Anyway, so when we get into this temple system, the tabernacle, temporary, the temple is, it was a structure that was static. It was in one place. It was obviously, it was torn down, so temporary to an extent, but it's an actual building. I think we're all familiar with the temple. So within the temple, there are ordinances all throughout the Old Testament. There are people that work within and without the temple, and everything is done in alignment with the Word of God and the instruction books of the priesthood, which would be the Mishnah and sometimes the Talmud. Christ quoted from all of these things. So an interesting thing about this guy, the captain of the temple, is one of his primary functions was to make sure that this one particular chamber in the temple was ready for service each and every day. And this temple, this chamber inside the temple, I think we're all familiar kind of with the temple structure. You may have even heard of like the court of the Gentiles, the court of the women, the Nicanor gates, the holy place, the holy of holies, the Ark of the Covenant. That's all temple stuff. One thing that you don't hear much about are the administrative chambers within the temple and what had to be done every single day. One of these administrative temples was called the Chamber of the Hearth or the Chamber of Fire. And it sat right next to the Chamber of the Spark. Immediately when I read that for the first time, you can find a lot of information about this on thetempleinstitute.org. When I saw those names, and we can just go ahead and throw the only slide up there. It's a general information. I'll explain it here in a moment. As a guy, but maybe as a human, I don't know if I've only ever been a guy, the Chamber of Fire, the Chamber of Spark, as soon as I read that, for me, it was like, hold on a second. What is this? I've never heard of this. This sounds ultra cool. It's like there's a chamber of Xbox and PlayStation. Like, is there a chamber of Call of Duty? I didn't know that this existed. The Chamber of Fire, the Chamber of Spark, that's a way cooler temple already than what I thought. And I thought the temple was kind of cool, but I didn't know that it got crazy like this. So what is going on with the Chamber of Fire? That sounds intense. And I think up here it's called the Place of the Hearth. You call it the Chamber of the Hearth. Within the Chamber of the Hearth or the Chamber of Fire, there are four separate rooms, as you can see in this picture here. This is called the, really C-H-O-L is a better way to spell it. This is a sanctified court in blue, and this is the court of the chol in the red. So in Hebrew, this would be the chol or the chol and the kadosh. What that means is that the blue side, the two chambers on the blue side are holy, and the two chambers on the red side are common, would be the word. They are not sanctified as holy like the two chambers on the inside. So the chambers on the upper chambers are facing the outside, and they're accessible by people on the outside. The chambers on the inside are only accessible to the priesthood, and they are considered holy ground. So this guy, the captain of the temple, he'd have to walk into this hallway every day that was divided from the holy and the common. And he would have to walk between these four chambers. This was his duty to get the temple system and the sacrificial system in order day in and day out. So I want to talk to you about these four chambers. But I want to relate this. This is part of the heart of the temple. Okay, within this system is literally the daily bread that kept the priests fed and the sacrificial lambs that kept the ordinances and the temple going. So this is literally the beating heart of the temple. And that's one reason why it's called the hearth or the fire, because just like there's got to be a place inside of you that is pumping out the blood, that is the heart of the system, the fire that's in you is the never sleeping, and they were not allowed to sleep. There actually were certain times where certain people could sleep as long as somebody else was awake. But this had to be going on 24/7, and it had four specific chambers, and your heart has four specific chambers. And we're going to talk about the relationship between these, but also the very distinct ministry of Christ on this day. So without further ado, the holy chambers in the blue, the first one that he would walk past, but he wouldn't just walk past it. Actually, when he came into the Chamber of the Hearth, down the hallway, in the middle of the hallway, was a marble slab. And on top of the marble slab were not ice cream toppings like you're thinking. I know as soon as I said that, that's exactly where your mind goes, which is fine. Everybody loves that. But this is even more important, believe it or not, than marble slab ice cream. So on that marble slab, there was a golden chain that was adhered to the slab. And on that golden chain, there was a set of keys. And so the captain of the temple would have to march in there every morning. He'd march right past a Levitical priest. And he would literally tell the Levitical priest, because morning and evening sacrifice, this guy was working a night shift or he was working the morning shift into the night. He would tell them, don't go to sleep yet. You know, let me go finish my duties. I'll come tell you as soon as I'm done so you can take some rest. They had to have that exchange. And so he goes in, he grabs the keys off the chain, and he begins to check and do his administrative work in the four chambers. The first chamber on the blue side is the chamber of sacrifice, where they kept the sacrificial lambs and on some days other animals to be sacrificed for special events. So this is a chamber of the sacrificial lambs. On the other blue side is the chamber of the shewbread. If you're not familiar with the shewbread was the only bread in the temple, which was the only thing that the priests got to eat out of the temple. That was their food for the day whenever they were ministering in the priesthood. Now check this out for you and I. You may have designated in your mind that you're a believer, but you're not. Not just. You may have designated in your mind that you're a Christian, but you're not. Not just. Okay, these are modern day words, and fill in the blank, there might be two or three others that you consider yourself, but the Bible considers you a holy priesthood. The Bible says that when you've accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, you haven't just gained salvation, you have turned in your will for his will, and you come into service with the Lord. Okay, it's not coming to the altar just to receive eternal life and then go on about your day, sir. It is coming to the altar to turn your will over, allow his spirit into the chambers of your heart, and make a commitment to a life of servitude in him, so that now you are part of the holy and eternal priesthood as he is a priest after the order of Melchizedek. So if to this point you've been a believer and you've been wondering where the power of God is, where the answers to my prayer are, where are the things that I read about in the Bible, well, maybe you've just been a Christian, my friend, all of your life. Stop being just a Christian. Stop being just a believer. Turn your will over and enter into the holy priesthood of the Most High, because that is the offer on the table from your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And he died for that offer, and he overcame death for that offer, so that you get to walk. When you decide to serve the kingdom, you become a priest in the kingdom. It's a whole different ballgame, and your sustenance is the shewbread and the shewbread alone. How was the shewbread set up? It was 12 loaves that were changed out every Sabbath. So the shewbread was given new every Sabbath day. Those 12 loaves were stacked, six on the left and six on the right, so that if you were to count them, you would have six and six. So it was daily bread made new once a week, six and six. How about your Bible? 66 books split in two separate sections. We worship and we read about it every 7 days on the Sabbath. And hopefully it's fresh and it becomes new. And it's the only meal that will sustain your spirit whenever your spirit comes into alignment with his spirit. And you're not just a believer or a receiver, but you're a priest. You're a priest. And listen, you don't have to, it's fine what you're wearing right now. Okay? It's not weird to be a priest. You don't have to walk around in a gown. You don't have to have rubies on your chest. You don't have to have a turban on. You don't have to do any of that. Okay, that all served a purpose. Those were all types and shadows as well. It's fine. You don't have to show up to the church 7 days a week. There's nothing that you have to do. Jesus did it all. All he's asking you to do is accept the covenant that he bled for and make your everyday life an act of priesthood and worship. I drink my coffee as unto the Lord. Okay, you should. Like, I'm thankful. Most of the time, sometimes it's awful, but still I'm like, but at least I have coffee, right? So you got to find the silver lining, but anything good that you have in this life, you don't deserve it. So everything that happens to each breath, thank you, Lord. Well, you don't understand my life. My body's ravaged. My life is messed up. I know, and it's terrible, but the thing is, you're on your way to eternal life. If you knew next week you were going to win the 900 million Powerball, everything that you experienced this week would be like water off your back. It doesn't matter. What would you suffer to make sure you had that winning lottery ticket? Probably a lot, but you have something far better. You have the blessed assurance of an eternal life without pain, without sorrow, without sin, in the presence of your loved ones, and at the feet of your Lord and Savior, in his spirit, at all times. You don't even need the light from the sun, because he is going to be so glorious. So I'm not, it's human nature to be upset about the things you have to suffer, but keep that in the frontal lobes of your brain. I've got, it's worth it. It's worth it. And the things you can do as a suffering saint, they equate to rewards in the heavenly realm. So it's worth it. This is a table of shewbread. And then Jesus said, of course, John chapter 6, verse 35, said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger. And he that believes on me shall never thirst. He's not saying literally, if you serve me, you're never going to be physically hungry. He's saying, if you give your life to me, your spirit will never be famished. Okay, he's the bread. He's the shoe bread. He's the daily bread. He's here every Sabbath. He's here every day. And guess what? He's the Word of God, and the Word of God is 66 books, and the shoe bread was 6 and 6. Split in two. Word of God happens to be split in two. This is not a coincidence. We go back up to the chamber of the sacrificial lambs. We probably don't need too many scriptures about that, but there are some very specific things that happen on this day. Matthew 26, verse number 36 through 45. Then Jesus, who is the high priest, but he's also the captain of the temple. He's also the sacrificial lamb. He's also the God being sacrificed too. He's everything. Then comes Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane. And he said unto the disciples, sit here while I go and pray yonder. Sounds like he had Texas on the brain. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, James and John, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. And he said unto them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry here and watch with me. And he went a little further, and he fell on his face, and he prayed, saying, oh, my Father, check this out. You can read this directly on the Temple Institute. So the captain of the temple would grab those keys. He would unlock the door to the chamber of the sacrificial lambs. He would go in and reinspect the lambs. Only the ones without spot and blemish were allowed in that room. But he would inspect them again. He'd choose one for the sacrifice of the day. And the one that was chosen for the sacrifice of the day was given drink out of a golden cup to prepare his hide for the sacrifice. So you choose one lamb. You take the golden cup of the temple. You give it to him to drink, and it's to prepare him to die. Jesus says, the Lamb of God takes away the sin of the world. Father, if possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Not as I will, but as you will. That's the defining element of the follower of Christ. That's our motto. That's our war cry. You want to be in his will. You want to make sure your life, you're walking in his will. You want to be a man or a woman of great faith? That's the ticket. There's no Hebrew word for faith. You go look up faith in the Old Testament, you're going to find it about 4 times. You look that word up in Hebrew, it's not faith, it's faithfulness. That's the only word that exists. Great faith is not somebody that believes for big miracles. In fact, Jesus called them ye of little faith every time they needed a miracle to survive. He said, wow, you have a little faith. In other words, he's saying like you're not very faithful when things get tough. You need miracle, miracle, miracle to survive. I'm not a magician. I'm not here to do miracles, miracles. I'm here for the gospel. I will confirm the gospel with signs and wonders. I'll do that from now until eternity. But I'm not giving you miracles for your salvation. I'm not performing miracles so you'll love me. You have very little faithfulness to me if you need a miracle every time things get tough. That's what he was saying. So you want to be a person of great faithfulness, this is the ticket. Nevertheless, Father, not my will, but thy will be done. That's the whole prayer. Great faithfulness is staying the course. And that's what Jesus said. It's okay to be nervous. It's okay to be stressed out. He prayed until blood dropped from his foot. That was very stressful. High cortisol levels. It's okay. You can even ask for the cup to be passed from you as long as you finish it with that statement. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. So he's fulfilling the the role of the captain of the temple. He's fulfilling the chamber of the sacrificial lambs. He's fulfilling the chamber of the shewbread. The word was made flesh. Okay, those are the two holy chambers. Those are two things that only Jesus can do. The two chol or common chambers are things where common man plays a part. So the first one's called the chamber of seals. In the chamber of seals, they would literally, depending on the sacrifice they were bringing that day, they had to bring enough money to purchase the correct seal to go turn into the guy who was in charge of the wine and the flour, because you have to have the right libations to meet the sacrifice that you're bringing. So it would be literal money exchange. You need the right size seal to match the size of your sacrifice so you can turn the seal in at the time of the sacrifice for enough wine and flour to meet the Levitical statute. So this is called the Chamber of Seals. There were two adjudicators within the chamber, two treasurers. Interestingly, right down the middle, there were two tables. There was a guy an accountant on the left, accountant on the right. And right down the middle was this cascade of limestones that were coming out of the wall. It looked like a really, really, really crazy scene. I don't think that it was in that slide, but it's not too hard to find. And that those stones were the stones left over from the first temple when Antiochus Epiphanes defiled it by sacrificing a pig on the altar. They took the stones that were covered in the pig's blood and they stacked them in this chamber as a reminder. They cleaned them and they stacked them. And it was in this chamber that the money was exchanged and the seals were purchased. They were purchased in a room with defiled stones covered in blood. Just as a side note. Romans 11:35 through 12:1. This is where we play a part. What do we bring to him? What do we exchange and what do we get? Romans 11:35. Who has first given to him and has not been recompensed again? And that goes right into 12:1. Romans 12:1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. That's doubling down on what we've already said. As a Christian, you might pray, God, what is your will for my life? Maybe a better prayer, or at least one that's more approachable as far as you doing something about it, is, Lord, what is my reasonable service? What reasonable service do you need out of me? And the answer is this. You can walk in. You have access to the chamber of the seals. So nobody's ever given to me and not received recompense. That's what Romans is saying. So I want you to walk in, and your body is the living sacrifice. I want you to give unto me your reasonable service, and I will make sure that you're sealed for eternity. I'll make sure there's enough wine and enough flour for your sacrifice, but your sacrifice needs to be yourself. Give me your body as a living sacrifice, and I will pour out the wine, and I will provide the flour, and I will give you the proper seal. Okay, that's chamber number three. The other common chamber, the last thing he would do with these keys in his hand, is he would go to the chamber of the immersion or the chamber of the mikvah. Mikvah or immersion in the Old Testament got translated into the idea of baptism in the New. Baptism is kind of a made-up word, but the idea is still the same, except that there was no room for opinions about mikvah. It had to be 6 feet deep. It had to be running water. You had to go underneath it. There was no sprinkling. There was no this. Can we do it here? There was nothing. You can't. There's no conversation. Okay, this is how it is. And they didn't mikvah or baptize once for as part of the plan of salvation. They mikvah daily because it wasn't about being saved. It was about being clean or unclean. In the New Testament, that's why it's called an answer of a good conscience towards God, because you can't actually clean yourself by cleaning your body like they did in the Old Testament. It was a type and a shadow of how the Word of God cleans our mind. It is the water of the Word. So baptism being a physical example of that. But here, let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. And here's why I want to go to 2 Corinthians 5, 21. Because although we have access to these two chambers, Christ still had to fulfill these two chambers. He obviously did with the seal of the Holy Ghost and the sacrifice of his own body in that other chamber. But here, I struggled a little bit because it's not a holy chamber, it's a common chamber, but it's a chamber of cleanliness. It seems like it should be holy because you go down to the water and you're made clean. So I didn't understand why the Lord would put the designation there to make sure that this was a common room or an unholy room instead of a holy and sanctified room, especially in the essence of Christ and what he came to do. And then it struck me the same thing that will strike you here, 2 Corinthians 5:21. Though he was perfect, though he knew no sin, he has made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So he, in this room, it was interesting. You walk into this room and there's a spiral staircase. There's not a mikvah. And you have to descend all the way down the staircase to go into the mikvah, to come back up and ascend up the staircase and be clean enough to administrate the actual ministry of the other three chambers. Now, he'd go in and check and make sure everything was in order. But in order to walk into the fourth one, grab the lamb, and walk it down for sacrifice, he first had to ascend all the way down into a pit, and then he had to come all the way back up clean. Now, that's pretty interesting, because the Bible tells me that Jesus Christ, whenever he was carried into that grave and his body was laid on top of that stone slab, that marble slab, that his spirit descended into the earth, the Bible says, into a place called Abraham's bosom, where he met all of the faithful saints of old, because nobody could go to heaven before him, because he was the first fruits of God and the first fruits of them that slept. So there he was, and he took the gospel with them. They saw the Lord and the Savior, the Messiah they'd been waiting on. And the gospel of Matthew tells us point blank, Jesus was not resurrected alone. There were a multiplicity of saints that were resurrected with him, went into the great city, and were seen by many people. So what is going on here? He is fulfilling the role of the captain of the temple. He has walked in, and he has checked to make sure that the cup is being drunk by the lamb. This is in the Garden of Gethsemane. He has walked by the Levite at the outer door, and he said, don't sleep. How many times did he tell his disciples that? Can you please stop sleeping? So he went off and he prayed three times. Why? Because he has three chambers to check before he can do the last one. So he walks in and he makes sure that the word is set. The table of shewbread is ready. He walks in. He makes sure that the seals are prepared for those that are bringing their sacrifice. He walks in, and as he's laying in the chamber of the grave, in the spirit, he descends the spiral staircase down into the belly of the earth. He walks into Abraham's bosom, and he brings all of those that were waiting with him out of the mikvah, if you will, of Abraham's bosom, ascending back up the spiral till everybody sees them on the earth. And so now we have the captain of the temple, and he has to have keys in his hand. There were keys on a chain on the marble slab. So up comes Jesus with keys in his hand, because he now has keys to death, hell, and the grave. Three chambers. And he's walking to the fourth chamber that can't be used yet because it's the sacrifice of the lamb. And he's doing all of this. And he's walking to the chamber. And he's making sure that all of it is done. And as the captain of the temple, once it's all done, you go into the room. You make sure the lamb is ready. And then you take off your priestly garments, your white linen robe. You fold it up nicely. And you lay it down on the marble slab. Then you exit the chamber. And you tell the Levite, okay, now your shift is over. If you'd like to sleep, go ahead. Let's read. Let's go ahead and get our worship team up. Let's read the rest of Matthew real quick. So he says in verse 41 of Matthew 26, watch and pray that you do not enter into temptation. Okay, the spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, oh, my Father, if this cup may not pass from me, except I drink it, your will be done. Verse 43, and he came and he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, and he left them, and he went away, and he prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then comes he to his disciples and said unto them, this is very, very interesting. Sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Let's look at verse 47. Is that where we ended? Verse 45, 46. Go back to 46. I didn't write enough verses. Oh, yeah, here we go. I meant to put this on here. But this is where it becomes interesting. So let's read, keep that up there. I'm going to read 45 and then read 46 together with me. Then he comes to his disciples after a third time. He says, sleep now and take your rest. And then the very next verse he says, now get up. What's going on here? Seems to be an issue. So now we can sleep, or now we're going, like, I would be very confused, right? So he's very mad at them for sleeping. Then he says, okay, it's all done. Now you can sleep. Now get up and let's go. What he's talking about is like he's been talking about the whole time. This isn't about physical sleep. This is about in the spirit. Because he said, don't fall asleep lest you be tempted. But we don't normally get very tempted in our sleep. We run into a lot more temptation during the day. So it wasn't about the physical sleep. It was about the spiritual sleep. Like, don't close your eyes on this thing. It is not time to rest. We're right at the crux. I need you to stay awake with me. Then when he comes out, he says, sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Jesus Christ, the Bible says, he came to give us rest. The rest, the Bible says, is the outpouring of his spirit. The rest is the Holy Ghost. It doesn't mean that when we receive his spirit that we can close our eyes and not pay attention. It means when we receive his spirit, we have the ability to call on his spirit. We have the ability to walk in the spirit. You don't have to be anxious against how the enemy is going to attack you. You have a shield, you have a buckler, you have a great reward. You see that you're stumbling, you see that you're falling, he doesn't count it against you. You're a part of his kingdom, you're in the priesthood. All you have to do is call on his Spirit. Pray, ask the Lord. Say, Father, this is what he told them. The Spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak, right? My flesh is weak. Let your Spirit rise up inside of me. Help me. Help me be a better priest in Jesus' name. So the main thing that I want to bring to you this morning, this is just the little bit that we know. But when Jesus went into that grave, he went in as the captain of the temple. He fulfilled all the ministries of the captain of the temple. He got put there as the lamb that was slain for sin from the foundation of the world. He fulfilled all the ministries, all of the chambers within the chamber of fire. Two that were things only he could do, two that were things that require you to be there. Interesting thing about your heart. You have four chambers in your heart. Ventricles on that side serves to pump in the oxygen-rich blood. And so there's a cycle that goes on with your heart. It goes from the body, so the blood circulating in your body goes in through two chambers into your heart without much oxygen. Your heart then pumps that blood into your two lungs to receive oxygen. Then the other chambers of the heart receive the oxygen-rich blood and then pump it out back into the body. The body uses the oxygen until the blood is depleted, and then it pumps it back in through the other chambers again. So it's very interesting. You have two chambers dedicated to oxygen-depleted blood and two chambers dedicated to oxygen-rich blood. Guess what oxygen represents? In the Bible, the word spirit and the word breath and the word oxygen are all the same word. It's the ruach in Hebrew. It's the pneuma in the Greek. The body is the body of Christ. Our heart as the body and your heart exists with two chambers. One that represents your body as a living sacrifice, and one that represents the mikvah of Jesus Christ, the cleanliness that you get from his blood. And what those two chambers serve are chambers that pump in oxygen-depleted blood. And then the spirit that is within you, it strengthens the blood and makes that oxygen rich so that it comes out of the two covenants of your lungs, the two covenants of the Word of God, which strengthens the oxygen and puts it back into the body as spiritually strong blood so the body can use that. And then throughout the week, guess what? If you're doing it right, you're going to find that there are times throughout the week when you feel weak, when your spirit feels weak, and you need to be replenished, you need to be reloaded. Guess what the Bible says the purpose of church is? It is to bring in the saints, not the non-believers. It's fine. I'm not saying they shouldn't come. But the purpose, the main purpose, is to bring in the saints and make sure that they are equipped for the week. It is a refueling station. It is the place where the Spirit of God should be present as the saints should come in a little bit depleted from everything they've given out during the week as evangelists. They come into the house of God. They receive from the Spirit of God. They get filled back up in those chambers so they can go and minister in the other chambers. Jesus Christ, the high priest of God, the captain of the temple, your Lord and your Savior, the lion and the lamb. He is everything in the Word of God. He is the beginning and the end, and he owns the keys of death, hell, and the grave. And he did not just rise again to give you eternal life. He rose in fulfillment of the entirety of the Word of God so that you have a lifetime of priesthood available to you here on your way to eternal life there. So that's our Passover Easter message this morning. If you love the Lord your God, stand to your feet. Let's worship him.